this life, some things are bound to change, but one thing remains the same. We all need love. Time goes by, moves like a hurricane, and through all the wind and rain, we all need love.
As this world just keeps on turning round and round, there are treasures to be found if we just let compassion lead the way.
Draw back your bow, let love go. Shoot straight for the heart with all of your might. Set your sight, take aim from the start to love God.
Love people, that's the center of the mark. Ooh, ooh,
ooh. Ooh, every day, through what is and is to come, when all has been said and done, we all need love. So Jesus came, gift from the heart of God. He gave us his life because we all need love.
And the love and death could not keep in the grave is alive in us today. So we must live to show the world the way.
With all of your might, set your sight, take aim from the start
to love God. Love people,
that's the center of the mark.
Good morning, church. Good morning. It's a beautiful day in the house of the Lord today. We are hoping that you will join us. If you'll please stand, we're going to sing and praise the Lord this morning as we always do, loud. And let's let the Lord hear us this morning.
Sunrise every morning. It's like a picture that you've painted for me. A love letter in the sky. Story. I could have had a really different story. But you came down from heaven to restore me. Forever save my life. Nobody loves me like you love me, Jesus. I stand in awe of your amazing ways. I worship you as long as I am breathing. God, you are faithful and true. Nobody loves me like you. You're breaking down the weight of all my mountains. Even when it feels like I'm surrounded, you never leave my side. Whoa. Nobody loves me like you love me, Jesus. I stand in awe of your amazing ways. I worship you as long as I am breathing. God, you are faithful and true. Nobody loves me like you. A song to sing. Oh, what a song to sing. Oh, what a song to sing. Oh, what a song my heart keeps singing. Oh, what a song to sing. Oh, what a song to sing. What a song to sing. Jesus, you love me and I love you, God. Nobody loves me like you love me, Jesus. I stand in awe of your amazing ways. I worship you as long as I am breathing. God, I will worship you. Forever worship you. Nobody loves me like you love me, Jesus. I stand in awe of your amazing ways. I worship you as long as I am breathing. God, you are faithful and true. Nobody loves me like, nobody loves me like you love me, Jesus. I stand in awe your amazing ways. Nobody loves me like you. Nobody loves me like you.
Amen. Let's keep singing to the Lord. I count on one thing. The same God that never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting. Same God who's never late is working all things out. You're working all things out. Yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy. All my days, oh yes, I will. For all my days, oh yes, I will. Sing that again. I count on one thing. Same God that never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out. You're working all things out. Yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will
bless your name. Yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy all my days. Oh, yes, I will for all my days. Oh, yes, I will, and I choose to praise, to glorify the name of all names. Nothing can stand against. I choose to praise, to glorify the name of all names. Nothing can stand against. I choose to praise, to glorify the name of all names. Nothing can stand against. Yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy all my days. Oh, yes, I will for all my days. Oh, yes, I will for all my days. Oh, yes, I will.
Amen. Welcome to worship. You may be seated.
All right, well, good morning. I'd like to welcome you to Waco Springs Baptist Church. If you're our guest, know that we're glad that you're here with us and you've chosen to worship with us today. Before we continue in song and praise, I want to share with you in Romans chapter 8. So most of you know what these, not this, this is a microphone, but these devices. This is a loaner phone, by the way, because I dropped mine and it doesn't work right now and it's being repaired, hopefully. And you know what these devices are, right? But many of us can remember a time where we didn't have cell phones and we carry them around. So if you needed to get in touch with somebody, you either had to go to a store or a pay phone or just get over it, right? And just wait till later, hopefully. You know, the things that we consider so urgent now would be like, why are you telling me that? Like, I don't need to know that right now, right? But we do. We send messages quickly. Sometimes they're read wrong because we send it a text message. So you read that with your mind and not with the person who sent it. And then sometimes our signal gets broken up, and the message doesn't get received correctly, or the signal's dropped, or something happens, it's staticky, and I can't tell what the person's talking about. So when we think about communication between people, a lot of times it's messed up. And that's just part of living in a sinful world. Technology breaks and messes up. Sometimes we say the wrong thing. Sometimes it comes across the wrong way. But when we think about prayer in our communication with God, this is one of the greatest privileges we have as believers, because through Christ, we are welcomed into the throne room of God. And we're welcomed into the throne room of God to come to Him in prayer, to speak to God about the things of life and about our lives lining up with His will and for His will to be done in the world around us. And for Christians, for those who are in Christ, that prayer, a lot of times we may feel like we're going to mess it up, right? Well, we're going to get it wrong, or it's going to come out wrong, or the signal's going to get dropped, or somehow what I'm praying about isn't going to line up with what God's doing, and somehow that's going to make it clash, right? And some kind of weird, you know, alternate timeline's going to open up, and God's going to be like, well, that was your fault. You know, that's not how this works. One, the privilege to pray and to come to God comes through Christ and Christ alone. And second, the Holy Spirit intercedes for us so that when our stumbling and fumbling and bumbling as humans comes to God in prayer, it comes the right way and in line with God's will. Now, we may look at that answered prayer and go, well, that wasn't really what I had in mind. But it's exactly what God had in mind. And prayer is as much a benefit for us aligning with the will of God and being in communion and fellowship with God as it is anything else. Romans chapter 8, verse 18. First thing we get is several things that we can look at to pray about, but then how God responds through the Holy Spirit in our lives and in the world around us. For For I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing to the glory that is to be revealed to us. For the creation waits with eager longing for the revealing of the sons of God. For the creation was subjected to futility, not willingly, but because of him who subjected it, in hope that the creation itself will be set free from the bondage to corruption and obtain the freedom of the glory of the children of God. For we know that the whole creation has been groaning together in the pains of childbirth until now. And not only the creation, but we ourselves who have the first fruits of the Spirit groan inwardly as we wait eagerly for the adoption as sons, the redemption of our bodies. For in this hope we were saved. Now hope that is seen is not hope, for who hopes for what he sees? But if we hope for what we do not see, we wait for it with patience. Likewise, the Spirit helps us in our weakness. For we do not know what to pray for as we ought. But the Spirit himself intercedes for us with groanings too deep for words. And he who searches hearts knows what is the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for the saints according to the will of God. And we know that for those who love God, all things work together for good, for those who are called according to his purpose. So I want to encourage you this morning to be in communication with God. There's lots around you to pray about. We live in a fallen, sinful world. A lot of things that we're unsure of are down the road ahead of us, but we could pray that our lives are in line with the will of God and that his will is done in the world around us. Let's pray. Dear Lord, we love you and we praise you. We thank you for today. We thank you for your word. We're thankful for Jesus who died in our place, who paid our price and brings us in peace and fellowship with you, our sins forgiven, for those who have placed their faith in Christ. And we come to you in prayer this morning, humbly before you, knowing you alone are God. And we just ask that your will be done in this church, in our families, our homes, in our own lives, and that we serve you well in this world as lights of hope and ones who share the gospel and the love of Christ. We love you and we praise you. Amen.
A couple more songs to the Lord, and we'd really love you to sing these with us. These are just beautiful songs. So let's let the Lord hear our song today. Drought and storm, what heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled and striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. Of God in helpless babe, this gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save, till on that cross, as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. Every sin on him was laid. Here in the death of Christ I live.
the ground, his body laid. Light of the world by darkness slain, then bursting forth in glorious day. Up from the grave he rose again, and as he stands in victory, sin's curse has lost its grip on me. For I am his and he is mine, bought with the precious blood of Christ. This is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand till he returns. The power of Christ, I'll stand. Forgiven because you were forsaken. I'm accepted.
You are condemned. I'm alive and well. Spirit is with me. Died and rose again.
I'm forgiven. Because you were forsaken, I'm accepted. You were condemned. I'm alive and well. Your spirit is within me. Because you died and rose again. Amazing love, how can it be? My King would die for me. Amazing love, I know it's true. And it's my joy to honor you. Amazing love, how can it be? My King would die for me. Amazing love, I know it's true, and it's my joy to honor you in all I do. I honor you. I'm forgiven. Because you were forsaken, I'm accepted. You were condemned. I'm alive and well. Your spirit is within me. Because you died and rose again. forgiven because you were forsaken. I'm accepted. You were condemned. I'm alive and well. Spirit is within me because you died and rose again. Amazing love, how can it be?
Ask our teachers to come forward as we release our children to Children's Church. 1 through 5, out these doors. K and below down off to this other side. Lord Jesus, thank you for just the opportunity to come before you and sing praise to you. A lot of places in the world, you can't do that, and there's just not this opportunity. Lord, we know that it is special to be here. We know that you're here. And Lord, we just pray that you continue to move in our midst and continue to drive us closer and closer to a relationship with you that lasts for all time. In your name we pray. Amen.
This morning I have three questions about God. I'd like to ask those questions and attempt to answer those questions from our passage of Scripture today, which is Acts chapter 12. If you go ahead and be finding that, Acts chapter 12, I have a question about God. The first question is this: is God fair? Is God fair? Verse 1 of Acts chapter 12. Now, about the time Herod the king stretched out his hand to harass some of the church, then he killed James, the brother of John, with the sword. Because he saw it pleased the Jews, he proceeded further to seize Peter also. Now it was during the days of the unleavened bread. So when he had him arrested, he put him in prison and delivered him to four squads of soldiers to keep him, intending to bring him out before the people after the Passover. So Herod, the king, he decides that he wants to persecute God's church. He's going to stretch out his hand, it says, and harass some from the church. And so obviously the place to start with that would be the leaders. And so he goes after the leaders of the church and James, the brother of John. Yes, this is the James and John that you're familiar with from the Gospels. James is arrested. He's thrown in prison. And Herod has him executed. So James the fisherman, the brother of John, the one that followed Christ, a faithful disciple of Jesus, one of the two sons of thunder, as Jesus nicknamed them, he's executed with the sword. Most likely that means he's beheaded. That's what happened to John the Baptizer. So this Herod here is not the same Herod that was around when Jesus was born. That would be Grandpa. Okay, so this Herod is grandson of Grandpa that was the one that had all the babies killed around Bethlehem at the time of Christ. And he's the father to, later in the book of Acts, Paul has to appear before, he's called before King Agrippa. And that's Herod Agrippa, so that's son. So that kind of gets locates this Herod. They were all called Herods. That was a title. And so this kind of locates this particular Herod. And he has James killed. And he saw, hey, man, the Jews like that. I mean, get me a round of applause from the Jewish population that hated the church. So he arrests Peter and he intends to do the same thing to him, but skip down to verse 11. We're going to back up and see how this happened, but verse 11 tells us what happened. When Peter had come to himself, he said, "Now I know for certain that the Lord has sent his angel and has delivered me from the hand of Herod and from all the expectation of the Jewish people." So Peter's arrested. He's put in prison. Herod intends to execute him as well. He's just waiting because of a Jewish festival. But God sends an angel, and he breaks Peter out of jail. But God didn't send an angel to break James out of jail. So let's go back to our question, is God fair? I think maybe in answering that question, we should say define fair. And I'd like to propose a better question. Is God sovereign? So we look at the situation and we say, and I think rightly so, there's a tension there in us, particularly if we would have, say, been John, James's brother, who knew both James and Peter, is it fair that there was no rescue mission launched for James? But yet God sent a rescue mission to rescue Peter from prison, but he didn't do that for James, and we would say, well, that's not fair. That's not fair. How could James be executed and Peter be released? Again, not that Herod chose to release him. God sent an angel. And the angel did supernatural, miraculous things, and Peter was released from prison, but not for James. There's no hint that James had sinned in any way. In fact, he's in prison and was executed because he was faithful to Jesus, not because he had denied or rejected Jesus or sinned some way against Jesus. And certainly the Lord loved James as much as he loved Peter. So how could that be? Have you ever wrestled with that before? Like how could this happen? And this person lost their life, and this person walked away, or this person lost their job, and this person was promoted, or how do we deal with that? Is God fair? And again, let me just refocus your mind on what I think is a better question. Is God sovereign? Is God the absolute ruler of the universe that he created? And the answer to that is yes. God is sovereign. He sits on the throne. He understands our struggles. He understands our limited knowledge. He understands the tension that sometimes certain actions create in us and the things that we don't understand. But at the end of the day, God doesn't answer to anyone. That doesn't mean it's wrong for us to ask and inquire and struggle. It just means that he's God and we're not. And because he's God and we're not, there will be certain things that you would expect you wouldn't understand, right? You don't want to admit it, do you? But it's true. There are certain things that you cannot understand, that I cannot understand because we're limited, we're finite. God is infinite and eternal. So how could the limited finite comprehend the actions of an infinite God? Now, he has revealed himself to us, but there are certain things that remain behind the curtain, and he doesn't often explain them to us. You see, he's God, and he has his own reasons for allowing James to die and Peter to live that are unknown to us. And certainly we have to understand that God did allow that to happen, right? If he is all powerful, then he certainly allowed that to happen. He doesn't have to explain to us, and if he did, we probably wouldn't be able to understand it. Let's go on a little journey here. Loosen up your fingers for a minute. Or if your fingers are too tight and you're afraid you'll spring a muscle or a ligament, then just look at the screen. Psalm 115 and verse 3, listen to this declaration. It says, but our God is in the heaven. He does whatever he pleases. Go back before the book of Psalms to the book of Job. Find chapter 38 in the book of Job and verse number 2. This is when God comes down and he's going to answer Job after Job asked all these questions about God. And Job talked about how unfair it was that he was treated the way that he was treated. And he actually said, if I could If I could subpoena God and get him a court of law, I would ask him these questions. And now God shows up and he says in verse 2, "Who is this who darkens counsel by words without knowledge? Now prepare yourself like a man. I will question you and you shall answer me. Where were you when I laid the foundations of the earth?" By the way, where were you? "Tell me if you have understanding. Who determines its measurement? Surely you know. Or who stretched the line upon it? To what were its foundations fastened? Or who laid its cornerstone? When the morning stars sang together and all the suns shouted for joy." Job, I understand you have some questions, but before you ask your questions, let me ask you a few questions. Where were you when I created the universe? I don't remember consulting with your firm on how to do it. In Isaiah chapter 46, verse 10. It talks about there's no one like God, declaring the end from the beginning and from ancient times things that are not yet done, saying, "My counsel shall stand and I will do all my pleasure." And then finally, not that it's the last word on it in the Bible, but it's the last verse that I've selected for today, in Daniel chapter 4. In verse 35, "All the inhabitants of the earth are reputed as nothing. He does according to his will in the army of heaven and among the inhabitants of the earth. No one can restrain his hand or say to him, 'What have you done?'" I think you may think, well, you're just giving us a theological lesson here. We're between sermon series, and you had to say something today, right? And so you just kind of landed on this. No, this is really a very important and critical aspect. Is God sovereign? Yes. We may struggle with, well, why did James die and Peter live? Why did God rescue Peter and not James? I'm just telling you, there's a lot to that story that we will never know. And at the end of the day, we have to say, we submit ourselves to the lordship of Christ, we submit ourselves to the sovereignty of the Lord, and we do not understand. It doesn't mean that we don't struggle, we do. But at the end of our struggle, we have to say our faith is in God. Allow me to read to you from this book. I've read this account to you before, but it really is, I think you should hear it again. It's from the book called When God Doesn't Make Sense by James Dobson. This is an older book. It's probably from the mid-90s. And so a gentleman, Dr. Jim Conway, his daughter, when she was 16, they found a tumor in her leg, and they found out it was malignant, and they said, "We're going to have to cut your daughter's leg off. We're going to have to amputate your daughter's leg. That's the only remedy." And he just said, "I can't accept that. We can't do that. We can't do that." And so he prayed, and he got his church, a large church, praying. And the people around the country were praying, and he went to his daughter, and he said, "They're not going to have to cut off your leg. God's going to heal you." And he said to the surgeon that he knew, he said, "Look, when you go in there, don't just amputate my daughter's leg. Confirm that God has done a miracle and she doesn't need her leg to be amputated." And he said, as I waited in the waiting room and the doctor didn't come out after a few minutes, and it stretched to 2 hours and 3 hours and 4 hours, he said, "I knew that they were amputating my daughter's leg, my 16-year-old daughter's leg." And he said, I didn't know how to handle that. And it's a long account. I'm not going to read it all to you. He talks about how that, as a pastor, that just really He said, if I'd been a liberal pastor that didn't believe the Bible to be literally true, I could have just kind of done book reviews and talked about irrelevant stuff. But I'm a pastor that believes the Bible, and I teach the Bible expositionally, and I'm struggling. He talked about how people would catch him afterwards and say, well, man, your daughter losing her leg, I know why that happened. It's because a revival started in our church from that. That's why God let that happen. And he didn't respond well to that. He's like, well, what happens when you backslide again? Is he going to take her other leg? If that's what it takes to keep your church revived, my daughter doesn't have enough body parts. Be careful what you say to people who are hurting. Sometimes it's okay to say the truth. I don't understand, but I love you, and I'm praying for you, and I'm weeping with you. So this is his conclusion, though. With all the struggle, all the heartache, he said, probably the most important thing I learned in this entire process is this. I became deeply aware that there were only two choices that I could make. One was to continue in my anger at God and follow the path of despair that I was on. The other choice was to acknowledge that God is God and somehow say, I don't know how all this fits together. I don't understand the reasons for it. I'm not even going to ask for an explanation. I've chosen to accept the fact that you are God and I'm the servant instead of the other way around. And I left it there. It was in that choice that I came to cope with my situation. I frankly admit, after all these years, I still struggle with some things. I still get sick to my stomach when I see my daughter hopping on one leg. But I've come to recognize that God has a higher purpose, and I just don't understand that purpose. I'm prepared to wait until eternity to receive the answers to my questions if necessary. Like Job, I'm now able to say, though he slay me, yet I will trust in him. It's either despair or the acceptance of his sovereignty. There are no alternatives, no other alternatives. Let me say it again. It's either despair or it's God. There's nothing in between. Our family has chosen to hold on to God. Is God fair? Not the right question. Certainly God is just and everything that he does is right. The bigger question is God sovereign? And the answer is yes. There are reasons that we will never comprehend for why James was not rescued and why Peter was. And God did not explain those to us. There's a second question. Is God powerful? Is God powerful? Well, we learn from Scripture that God is all powerful, and he can do anything that he chooses to do. And he does bust Peter right out of jail in an awesome and amazing way. Verse 5, Peter was kept in prison, but constant prayer was offered to God for him by the church. And when Herod was about to bring him out, that night Peter was sleeping, which is amazing, isn't it? I'm not sure I could have been sleeping if it's the night before your execution and Peter's in there asleep. That's pretty amazing. He was bound with two chains between two soldiers, and the guards before the door were keeping the prison. Now that seems like, okay, not even Jesse James and his gang could break Peter out of there, right? I mean, it's just, there's no way. It is impossible. Well, verse 7, behold, an angel of the Lord stood by him, and a light shone in the prison, and he struck Peter on the side and raised him up, saying, arise quickly, and his chains fell off his hands. Then the angel said to him, gird yourself, tie on your sandals. And so he did. And he said to him, put on your garment and follow me. So he went out and followed him and did not know that what was done by the angel was real, but thought he was seeing a vision. But when they were past the first and the second guard post, they came to the iron gate that leads to the city, which opened to them of its accord. And they went out and went down one street, and immediately the angel departed from him. And Peter, when he came to himself, he said, "Now I know for certain that the Lord has sent his angel and has delivered me from the hand of Herod and from all the expectation of the Jewish people." It's a pretty awesome escape account, right? That's better than escape from Alcatraz. I mean, Peter's in there asleep. There's just no way out. Might as well get your final good night of sleep. Got a guard, he's chained over here. Got a guard, he's chained over here. You got guards guarding the door. You got gates between him and the outside. We were told that there's all these soldiers that are guarding him. And suddenly an angel comes in. It's like, "Hey, Peter, get up." Peter, he doesn't know. Is this a vision? He thinks it's a vision. Hey, and he has to tell him, like, "Man, put your clothes on. All right, put your shoes on. All right, come on, follow me, let's go." And they go out, and all the guards are, they're supposed to be awake, but now they're asleep. They're not awake. And they're going out, and they're escaping. And so they come to the final gate, and it's like when you're at the airport or something, or at the store, you step on the door and it opens, right? Well, they didn't have any such thing in Peter's day, but yet, there it goes. He walks out, and the angel takes him a street further. He's like, "Okay, you're on your own now, buddy." And he's gone. Peter's like, "Man, this is real. I'm outside." And he goes to the church. He goes to the house where the church is meeting. Is God powerful? Can he do whatever he chooses to do? Is an escape like, well, God's like, "Man, I'd love to get Peter out of there, but look at all those guards." Of course not. God is all powerful. He can do anything that he chooses to do. Now listen to me. Don't become disinterested in engaging with God because of the first question. Some people do that. They're like, "Well, God's sovereign. Whatever he's going to do, he's going to do." And there's no need for us to pray or engage or witness or try to live right or to care, you know, take care of yourself or exercise. Whatever God's going to do, he's going to do. That's not what you see unfolding in the passage. Yes, the sovereignty of God is real. You also see in the passage the power of God. But the church is not disengaged. They're engaging with God in prayer. In fact, when Peter shows up, they're having a prayer meeting for Peter. Verse 12, when he considered this, he came to the house of Mary, the mother of John, whose surname was Mark. You've heard of Mark, right? There were many gathered praying. Peter knocked on the door. A girl named Rhoda came to answer. When she recognized Peter's voice, because of her gladness, she did not open the gate, but ran in and announced that Peter stood before the gate. Now, isn't this kind of interesting that this angel opens the gates and now Peter's like, "You can't even get in the gate because it's locked," and the girl doesn't open the gate? Kind of ironic. But she recognized, hey, that's Peter. She comes in. She's telling the prayer meeting. Verse 15, they said to her, "You're beside yourself. You're crazy. Peter's in jail. We're praying for his release right now. Peter's not outside the gate." She kept insisting, and they said, "Oh my, it's his angel. Maybe they've already killed him, and like his spirit is outside the gate or something." Peter kept on knocking. "Hey, come on, guys, open the gate." Because he's got to be thinking, "Man, wouldn't it be horrible to get this far, and now I can't even get in the gate, and they catch me again?" They finally opened the door. They saw him and were astonished. He motioned to them with his hand to keep silent. He declared to them how the Lord had brought him out of the prison. And he said, "Go tell these things to James and to the brethren." That's not the same James that was killed with the sword. That's James, the leader of the church in Jerusalem, to the brethren. And he departed and went to another place. You see the power of God on display here. That God is all powerful. You also see unveiled here, like in Genesis, where "Is anything too hard for the Lord?" was asked. Genesis 18:14, or Luke 1:37, where Gabriel said, "Nothing is impossible to God." Like Mary's like, How can I have a baby? Well, nothing is impossible to God. We believe that God is sovereign. We believe that God is all-powerful. We also believe that God commands us and invites us to engage with him in prayer. And you see in this story both the sovereignty and the power of God and the responsibility of man, don't you? Because Peter's been released, but he's not just walking up and down saying, hey, hey, hey. He's like, shh, be quiet. God got me out. Now what are you going to do, Peter? I'm going somewhere else. Right? God is sovereign. But the early church, they prayed. They believed fully in the sovereignty of God. But that didn't inhibit them from praying, because it's not an inhibition to pray. Yes, there's many mysteries behind the curtain. That, well, how does that relate to that? And how does, I don't know. I'm telling you, the greatest theologian you've ever heard of doesn't know either. Apart from Jesus now. Obviously, who is the greatest theologian you've ever heard of? But on barring God in the flesh, anybody you read, there's going to be some things that if they're honest, they'll say, I don't know how that relates to that. How do you explain that? This church did not host a debate on the sovereignty of God and the responsibility of man. I'm not saying it's a sin to have such a discussion. I'm saying that's not what they did. They engaged in prayer. And actually, their prayer, though it was passionate, they didn't actually believe when God had answered their prayer. Is God sovereign? Yes. Is God all-powerful? Yes. Can he do whatever he chooses to do? Yes. We're to engage God in prayer, crying out to God. But there's one final question. And this is kind of a little curveball in the story. Does God judge? Does God judge? Well, Herod thinks a lot of himself. Verse 20. Now Herod had been very angry with the people of Tyre and Sidon. But they came to him with one accord, and having made Blastus, the king's personal aide, their friend, they asked for peace, because their country was supplied with food by the king's country. So on a set day, Herod, arrayed in royal apparel, sat on his throne and gave an oration to them. And the people kept shouting, "The voice of a god and not of a man." Then immediately an angel of the Lord struck him, because he did not give glory to God, and he was eaten by worms and died. But the word of God grew and multiplied. So Herod, the one that had been so quick to strike James and wanted to strike Peter, he's got an audience that have come. They really want some food. Hey, open the supply lines to our country, but we know we've got to kiss up to you to get that to happen. So they're out there, and he's giving this speech. And the people start shouting, hey, this is not the voice of a man. This is the voice of a God. He obviously likes that. And as he's giving his speech, God sends an angel and boom, he judges Herod and he dies instantly. He's just gone. He's dead. Enough was enough. And God took his life. Does God judge? Now here's where you want to be careful. Because the world in which we live today, almost with one voice, will say to you, God does not judge people. God just accepts everybody. He wouldn't judge anyone. Certainly not like an immediate judgment like this, but certainly not a final, ultimate judgment day type scenario where, you know, you have to face God and you're judged and you're condemned for eternity. That's the voice of the world. But that's not the voice of the Bible. The Bible says the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness. The Bible says that that God loved the world. He sent his son Christ into the world. He demonstrated his love in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. And the Bible says right there in that John 3:16 passage in 17 and 18 where it says, for God so loved the world, he gave his only son that whoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. Right there in that very passage it says, the one who does not believe is condemned. Does God judge? Yes, he's a righteous God. He does judge sin. He's a God of grace. He's a God of mercy. But there comes times when God says enough is enough. And even right here, though it's rare, in Scripture, God breaks forth in judgment against people or groups of people. In the book of Acts, it's already happened at a church service, right? You've heard of Ananias and Sapphira? I mean, the ushers had to carry them out to the morgue. Now, God doesn't often do that. You say, what do you mean? Well, I mean, he doesn't often break forth like that. He does it at particular times to set an example or to make a point and to remind us of his coming judgment. I think it was J. Vernon McGee that said, if God did that at every church service, every church would need a morgue in the basement. So that's back to the sovereignty of God, right? He chooses at times to break forth. Do you think Herod's the only leader that was praised like a god? No. But God judged him in that moment. But understand, whether God breaks through in judgment immediately and we see it with our eyes, whether that happens or not, you can know for sure there's a judgment day, right? So God judging Herod is just a demonstration in this life of things to come. In chapter 17 and verse 31, with referencing the resurrection of Christ, while preaching to the philosophers in Athens. Verse 30, truly these times of ignorance God overlooked, but now commands all men everywhere to repent, because he has appointed a day on which he will judge the world in righteousness by the man whom he has ordained. He's given assurance of this to all by raising him from the dead. You see, it all comes back to Jesus, right? It all comes back to Jesus. You have to deal with Jesus. Now you can deal with him now. Lord, have mercy on me, a sinner. You receive the grace of God and the mercy of God. And whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved, but you reject him. Just reject him. And Paul said to those philosophers, this world is going to be judged. There's a day that God has appointed that he will judge this world. How do you know, he says? Because he raised him from the dead. You have to deal with Jesus one way or the other. Don't convince yourself there's no day of accountability. It could be that God could choose to break forth in judgment on anybody's life that's rejecting Christ or living in sin. He did it to Herod. He did it to Ananias and Sapphira. He did it multiple times under Moses' leadership. But those are rare. In Scripture, they're rare. But they point us, hey, one day there will be a time of accountability where every man must stand before God, every woman must stand before God. Don't convince yourself that God no longer judges. Are you prepared for the day of judgment? The only way you can be prepared for the day of judgment is to hide yourself away in Jesus Christ. He is the blood of the Lamb on the doorpost of the house that causes God to pass over his judgment. We sang about it. The wrath of God was satisfied. Amen. That was one of the lines in one of the songs this morning. You know, in the cross, the wrath of God is satisfied. And when you turn to Christ, you turn from your own way, you repent of your sins, you embrace him by faith. Lord, I know I'm a sinner. I know I need Jesus. There's no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. Is God fair? No. Is God sovereign? That's the better question. He is. Amen. There's a lot that we're just not going to understand. But we can proclaim, God, we believe that you are God and that what you do is right. And there are things that we struggle with. But we still acknowledge that you're God and we're not. Is God powerful? Yeah, he can get Peter out of prison. And by the way, he also can take James home from prison. I don't think there's a complaint department in glory. I really don't. We struggle. I doubt James had any struggle at the end of the line. I don't think he goes to heaven and he finds Jesus and says, I can't believe that you got Peter out and left me in. I don't think so. I'm confident that's not the way it is. God is powerful. We need to call on him. Look to him. Not disengage. Well, he's sovereign. Yes, he is. That should call us to engage. Because he's invited us to be a part of his kingdom and advancing that kingdom in this world. Yes, God does judge. You better take note. If you're not in Christ, watch out. You say, what do you mean watch out? I mean, if you were here a couple of weeks ago, just as clearly as we could, there's a Christless eternity that's horrible that awaits those who are not in Christ. Flee from the wrath of God. Flee to the grace of God. Embrace Jesus. Come to Jesus and be saved. I want to look at Jesus as my Savior. I mean, when I stand before him, that's my Savior. And God judged him for me. And I'm in him, so now God won't judge me. I don't want to stand before God. And God judges me for me. That's catastrophic. That's unthinkable. Some of you are struggling today. Lord, why did this happen? Why did that happen? I don't know all the answers to those questions. I do know, though, you need to come to rest that God is God. That doesn't mean you'll never struggle, because you will. There are lots of things that I struggle with. But at the end of it, I have to say, God, you're God, and I'm not, and I just don't understand. But I trust you. That may be what you need to do right now. God, I've been battling, I've been wrestling. God, I do proclaim my trust in you. But if you're not saved, come to Jesus. You'll find the grace and forgiveness that God has promised to those who are in Christ. Come to Jesus. Let's stand together. Lord, help us now. Lord, there are things that we struggle with. God, I've sought to wrestle with those in this passage. Lord, not as well as I hope to wrestle with them, but Lord, I give that to you. I present that to you as an offering. I've done what I could. I pray, God, that you would help that child of yours that is struggling with, why did this happen in my life but not in their life? I pray you'd help them just to place it at your feet. And yes, they may still have struggles in their heart about lack of understanding of why certain things happen, but Lord, help us to place it at your feet and profess that you're God and we're not. Thank you that you're powerful. Help us to engage in you and walk with you and pray, seek your face as you've commanded us to do. And Lord, we have a warning here in this passage too, a strong warning that reminds us that judgment is coming. I pray for anyone that's not hidden away in Christ, that they would put their faith in Jesus and be saved. In his name I pray. Amen.
Lord, I come, I confess, bowing here, I find my rest. Without you, I fall apart. You're the one that guides my heart. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour, I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh, God, how I need you. Sin runs deep, your grace is more. Grace is found, is where you are. Where you are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour, I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh, God, how I need you. So teach my song to rise to you. When temptation comes my way, when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you.
Jesus, you're my hope and stay. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh God, how I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh God, how I need you. Amen. Lord Jesus, thank you so much for this powerful word. Lord, just keep on working on us. Lord, we know that that you love us and we love you. Lord, just keep on developing that relationship and open doors in people's lives. In your name we pray, amen.